Good morning, students. So today we'll see some more concepts in oscillations. So here oscillations due to spring we are talking about. Okay. Some more points let us discuss. Now, let us say this is the spring which is connected to a mass. So this is my mean position and the spring is oscillating in this direction. If I call this direction as y direction, vertical plane, the spring is oscillating in this direction. It can be a simple harmonic motion. For simple harmonic motion, two conditions to be followed. One, the acceleration should be proportional to displacement with a negative sign. And it should be periodic. So you know that it can be expressed as a harmonic function. What is harmonic function? Any function which is expressed as a sine curve, sinusoidal, it's a harmonic function. Even a cosine function also is a harmonic function only, because cos theta is basically sine of 90 minus theta, you know. So here this point A and this point B, that is the maximum stretch that is possible. So if this is our mean position, this OA and OB, what are they? They are the amplitudes here, okay, and the time taken from A to B and back, time taken. So this is the mean, right? So O to A, T by 4, A to O, T by 4, O to B, T by 4, and B to O, T by 4. So one full cycle completed. So this is how it is. So we should not always think in terms of pendulum and all those things. Here also simple harmonic motion is happening. And when we calculate displacement, we calculate with respect to this mean position. Now here you write F is equal to minus kx, isn't it? So what is this? What are the different names of K? K is called a spring constant. It is also called force constant. Alright? It is also called stiffness constant. So if you find any other terms in the question, don't think that it is something else. Okay, stiffness constant, force constant, spring constant, and what are the units? Newton per meter is the unit. Suppose I give you two springs. One K1 value is 20,000 Newton per meter. Another 5 Newton per meter. So what can you say about these springs? This spring is very stiff. This spring is very stiff. You can say this spring is little soft. Okay? Why I am saying so? Because what is the meaning of this spring constant means? For 1 meter deflection. Okay? For 1 meter deflection, this much amount of force needs to be applied. Whereas here, for 1 meter deflection, this much force has to be applied. Which is more? This is more. So this much force, if you apply, let us say, to a spring from the mean position, it will be displaced by 1 meter. So large amount of force is required, isn't it? So large amount of force means it must be very stiff. It must be very strong. So looking at the spring constant values, we can say what type of spring is that. Okay. So now, while discussing the simple harmonic motion, we have also talked about the expression for time period. This time period T can be found out by 2 pi root over n divided by k. 2 pi root over n divided by k gives the time period for oscillations happening in a spring. Look at this expression. Do you find any G here? No. Do you find any G over there? There is no G over there. So if you take this pendulum, if you take a pendulum, not pendulum, if you take a spring, you take it on Earth or Moon, the time period won't change. The time period won't change, isn't it? Because in this expression there is no G value. It is independent of G. It is independent of the time period. Is this is what I am trying to say. Independent of G value. On Moon, what is the G value? It is approximately G by 6. On Moon, the value of G is approximately G by 6. So on Earth it is 10 meter per second square. On Moon it will be 10 divided by 6. Okay, 5 by 3. You just remember that value. Just note down. All right. Now, the point what we have discussed, time period what we have calculated, t is equal to 2 pi root over n divided by k. So, which type of spring it is applicable? This type of spring? Yes. Then let us say, I attach a pulley okay, this is a pulley system connected with a spring. So here also this expression is valid. Suppose this is a vertical spring system, this is a vertical spring system. Okay, so in horizontal direction if I give, then also same expression is valid. Suppose you put it on an inclined plane. Then also the same expression is valid. Okay. So, yeah. Now some more points. Let us say you are given a spring. This is mass, alright, and you are asked to find out, you are being told that the spring is negligible mass. Spring is of negligible mass. Ignore the mass. The spring also will have some mass, no? It will have some 100 grams, 500 grams, something it may have. Then you can use this expression. Suppose in this mass 2 pi into root over m by k. Suppose in some other question they say that this spring mass also should be considered. And let us say that mass is given as m. So your answer will become t pi into root over m plus m divided by k. Why? Because this oscillation, what is happening in the previous case, when it is negligible mass, it is happening only because of this. But when you attach a mass, it is happening both because of the spring self-weight. The spring self-weight and as well as the mass which is attached to it. Okay? So, note this expression. Okay? Now, this spring constant K is inversely proportional to the length. This spring constant K is inversely proportional to the length of the spring. Okay, more the length, less will be the spring constant. So can we say KL is equal to constant? Can we say KL is equal to constant? So suppose two different springs are given of K1 and L1, K2 and L2. you can write k1 l1 is equal to k2 l2. Okay, this situation when it comes, when you have broken down that spring, a bigger spring, into two pieces of l1 and l2 length, two pieces of l1 and l2 length. Okay, so this is one expression. No, this scale is equal to constant. Okay? This scale is equal to constant. But let us say, so you can, as per the given condition, you can apply this condition in the numerical. Now let us say, a spring is there. A spring is there. It is of length L. Okay, and it is broken into two pieces of L1 and L2. Okay. A spring of length L is broken down into L1 and L2. This is having K1 and this is having K2. Okay. So how to frame the equation means, you can write like this. Let us say the total spring has got a spring constant of K. So you can write, what is this K1 L1 plus K2 L2 is equal to, let us say of the whole spring, some effective stiffness is capital K. So this is equal to K into L1 plus L2. This is how you can frame the equation. Okay. Basically, K multiplied by length is constant. So here, let us say K multiplied by length is 100. Now it has become 20 and 80. Let us say. Okay. So this 100 is equal to 20 plus 80. So this is 20, this is 80, this is 100. Like that. So this, a concept is useful for any numericals which are of this nature. Okay. And if the spring, if a big spring is there, and each spring, that big spring is broken down into n parts. All right. Each will have a stiffness of n k. Okay, what is this? Spring broken down into n identical parts. N identical parts. Each will have this much stiffness. Alright, so these concepts are useful. So let's see some more. Just note down. Now, so when we talk about springs, we have to definitely talk once about the combination of springs. We have to talk about the combination of springs. A simple concept. Let us talk a couple of points about combination of springs. Because many times questions are asked on this. So we have already finished our electricity chapter and all these things. How many types of combination we always discuss normally? Springs in series, springs in parallel. Like there are resistors in series, resistors in parallel, capacitors in series, capacitors in parallel. So let us say you have a situation like this. See, any chapter you study about combination, what is the basic idea you are trying to understand? You are trying to replace these two springs by a single equivalent spring. You are trying to replace these two springs with a single equivalent spring. So if that single equivalent spring is there, which is hypothetical, let us say, how much will be the stiffness coefficient, stiffness constant or force constant of that particular spring? That is what we are trying to understand. So what type of combination is this? Here there can be 2, there can be 20. We have taken only 2. So This is series, like your trend. Okay, so let us say here this is K1 and this is K2. Okay, and if I replace this with say an equivalent spring, let us say K effective. So here what is happening? The force which is taken by this is the force taken by this also. Okay, what is getting added up? Let us say this spring is displaced by 2 cm. Obviously from its mean position, the mean of this will be somewhere here. The mean of this will be somewhere here. So this spring, let us say, is displaced by 3 cm. So what is the total displacement? See, the total displacement will be 2 plus 3. So the displacements are adding up. But what is constant? The force is constant. Alright? So you can say x, let us say the total displacement is x, then x is equal to x1 plus x2. Can I write it like this? So here F say displacement adding up. I told you this, this way of studying, even while you were doing resistors, you were doing capacitors, you need to understand the pattern here. What is the pattern here? The force is same. So if the force is same and displacement adding up, what is this x? If F is equal to kx, what is x? It is F divided by k only. So F divided by which k we are writing for this? These two, x1 plus x2. This got displaced by x. So it will be F divided by the spring constant of this spring. It is k effective. Okay. Learn the derivation because many times in questions it is useful. Okay. So what is x1 of this spring? It is F divided by k1 and this is F divided by k2. So from here you get 1 by k effective is equal to 1 by k1 plus 1 by k2, or k effective is equal to k1 k2 by k1 plus k2. Right? So suppose there are 3, 4 more, then it will be 1 plus 1 by k3 plus 1 by k4 and so on and so forth. So from here you will get the reciprocal. Do not forget to inverse it. Do not forget to inverse it for the final answer. So if it is k1, k2, if it for two strings, you can directly write k1, k2 by k1 plus k2. Now, suppose this spring is, let us say 10 and this is 20. What you are going to get? K effective will be equal to 10 into 20 divided by 30. How much? It is 20 divided by 3. It is 6.67. It is less than these two. So when we are connecting strings in series, the resultant you can say, the equivalent you say, the spring constant will be lesser than the least one. Okay? Remember this point. Now let us see the parallel. Understood, no? This equation to remember, and you should also remember this point, that the least value will be lesser than the least value. Alright. Now let us see the parallel. Now parallel. Suppose you have a system like this. You are trying to pull it. So this spring is K1 and this spring is K2. So here what is going to happen? This is a parallel situation. So let us say this spring is stiff. This is not very stiff. What will happen? You are pulling with some 100 Newton force. This fellow will take more force. 70, 30. You cannot say that forces are equal. Okay, what is equal here? Because this whole thing is a system, the displacement will be same here. In this situation, what will happen? It will be the reverse of that. Here, displacement will be same. Understood why? because both are different spring constants. If they are both same, both will share the forces. You put 100 total force here, K1 is equal to K2 is equal to K, both will take 50. But this is more strong, you will take more force. This is less strong, you will take less force before breaking down. Okay. So here force is divided. Force is divided. Right? So we can write here F is equal to F1 plus F2. And what is same here? Displacement is same here. Alright? So if this undergoes x displacement, this fellow also undergoes x displacement. So you can write here F is for the, you are replacing these two by a single spring like this. So its value is K effective. So you can write here K effective into X is equal to K1 into X plus K2 into X. So what did you get? K effective is equal to X is common, you can cancel out. So it is K1 plus K2. So here also, if this is 20 and this is 10, the effective is 30. So if you want to increase the effective spring constant, you should connect them in parallel. Okay, so if you want to increase the spring constant value, you should connect them in parallel. What are the units here? Newton per meter. Okay, let us move to the next one. Often this type of situation is given. Please hear carefully. This type of situation is given. Then what is this? It appears to be series, isn't it? No, they are connected in parallel. You should apply the parallel formula to this type of question. You know, it is often given to confuse. This is a special case where these two springs are connected in parallel but not series. Okay, it's a special case, please remember that. So here, if this is K1 and this is K2, if this is K1 and this is K2, your answer will be K dash is equal to K1 plus K2. Okay, so take a screenshot. Alright, so let us discuss some more points. Okay, now let us discuss the couple of points about the time period. So suppose two springs are connected in series. What about the time period? How the time period will vary? So this is spring 1, so it will have its own time period T1. This is spring 2, it will have its own time period T2. Now you are replacing this with a single system like this, isn't it? So you are trying to find out the time period for that equivalent system. So here, let us say the mass, everything is same. So what is the expression we have got? K dash is equal to K1 K2 divided by root over K1 square plus K2 square. Yes, sir. What nonsense I'm writing. K1 K2 by K1 plus K2 is what we have got for the springs in series. So put the values for T1 and T2 now. So T1, 2y into root over, the mass is m only, it is K1, right? And for T2, mass by, why I am doing all this? Because these are tested, these are frequently asked. That is what we are doing once. Okay? You can learn the derivation part, you can remember the formula. Whichever you are comfortable with. I will say know the method. Because even if you tend to miss the formula or you get confused about the formula, how much time it is taking to derive? If you are thorough with your concepts, hardly not even 1 minute it is taking. Okay? Especially for a competitive exam like JEE and JEE Advanced, you should be very thorough with your concepts, basic level concepts. Okay? So I would not suggest you to memorize blindly. But however, if you are comfortable with that, do it. T1, T2. Alright, just put the values over here. So let us say for the combined spring, the time period is T dash. Okay, so T dash will be equal to 2 pi into root over m divided by k prime. Okay, now this k prime, so from here, what am I getting? Here I am getting k1 square, if I square both sides, because I don't want to work with the roots. I don't want to work with the square roots. So squaring both sides, you get k1 is equal to 4 pi square m divided by t1 square. Simple. And k2, 4 pi square m divided by t2 square. And similarly, k dash will be equal to 4 pi square m divided by t dash square. Now put these values over here. So this is equal to 4 pi square m divided by t prime whole square is equal to 4 pi square m by t1 square into 4 pi square m by t2 square divided by 4 pi square m divided by t1 square plus m divided by t2 square. If I take 4 pi square m common, you write m into. Right? Did I miss anything? I did not miss anything. So you can see very well here that 1 m into 4 pi square you can cancel out here. Alright? There is one more here which you cancel out. This one also. So what are you left with? You are left with 1 divided by t dash square is equal to, you are getting here, 1 divided by t1 square t2 square, and you can also cancel out m also. You see m, okay, this m should have been outside. I made a little stupid move out. I didn't say mess up, not goof up. Goof up means covering up, I think so. So it should be 1 over here because I have taken m outside. So you are getting here 1 divided by t1 square by 1 divided by t2 square. So what is the next step? If this is equal to, on the right hand side, this is 1 divided by t1 square. T2 square, and this will be t1 square plus t2 square divided by t1 square plus t2 square. So basically this is divided by, it is t1 square plus t2 square divided by t1 square t2 square. Was I correct? So this is t1 square by t2. Alright, so here what happened here? 1 divided by t1 square, t2 square, and this is how much? This is 1 divided by t2 square, which is t2 square plus t1 square divided by t2 square. Yeah, okay, so this is divided by, so when you take the multiplication, this will go up. So it is 1 divided by t1 square t2 square into t1 square t2 square divided by t1 square plus t2 square. This is what you are going to get. And mind you, this is equal to 1 divided dash whole square. You can see these two are getting cancelled, and finally you are getting what? 1 divided by t dash whole square is equal to 1 divided by t1 square plus t2 square. Or if you take the reciprocal, you are getting t1 square plus t2 square. So this is the expression to calculate if two springs are connected in series, what is the combined time period. Okay, make a note of this, it's very useful. Suppose this time period is given as 4, this time period is given as 2. So what is the answer? Root over 4 square plus 2 square. See for the parallel case also. So suppose two springs are there which are connected in parallel, and you are trying to find out the combined, that is a TP we will call it. Okay. So here what was the situation? Here KP was equal to K1 plus KP. Right? So corresponding to KP, TP we are trying to find out. So our equation was T is equal to 2 pi into root over m by k. So what will be my kp? My kp will be the square root of x. So kp square is equal, kp is equal to 4 pi square into m by tp square. That is the right over here now. 4 pi square m divided by tp square is equal to 4 pi square m divided by t1 square and 4 pi square. 4 pi square, no? Pi square m divided by t2 square. So 4 pi square m is common thing. So you can write tp square is equal to 1 by t1 square and 1 by t2 square. Okay. So what will be my tp square? Inverse of this. So this will become 1 divided by t1 square t2 square. Okay. I would humbly request you, when you are taking this inverse, please don't put 1 by t1 as t1 and 1 by t2 as t2. No pun intended, but sometimes people do that also. Okay, you need to take the inverse like this. These are simple points, and I am telling specifically so that everyone get it, not just the bright student. Okay, the class is for all, knowledge is for all, isn't it? Knowledge is equal. So tp square will be this. So when you calculate this, you got what? Tp square will be equal to, this will go up to the top, t1 square t2 square by t1 square plus t2 square. This is the value of tp square. So what will be the value of tp? It will be root over, it will be root over this. So root over t1 square t2 square means it is t1 t2 divided by root over t1 square plus t2 square. So suppose this is 4 and 2, so what is the time tp? It is 4 into 2 divided by 4 square plus 2 square. So it is 8 divided by 16 plus 4, root 20. Root 20 means 2 root 5. So it is 4 by root 5 or 4 root by. This is certs, you know, normally we convert denominator, you never keep root values. You try to convert that into a regular rational number. So that's it from me today. So we will see some more points tomorrow. And main thing is you should remember the time periods, how to calculate for the things which are connected in series or parallel. If more numbers are there, you should adopt the procedure. See, for two numbers are there, you can put the formula. But if more numbers are given in the question, you should adopt the method and try to get the answer. Okay then? Till then, take care. Bye bye.